I've just bought what is probably the cheapest E92 M3 in the entire world.
And when I show you this thing, you're gonna start to understand why. Wait, I know exactly what you're thinking. Gross. We've all done it before. We're scrolling on the internet looking for the next project car and we see something for a pretty good deal. But there's this fire. There's this fire burning inside us that says, I can get that cheaper.
And that's exactly what I did. This is my 2012 E92 M3.
And I bought this car from 3 states away, completely sight unseen.
Because sometimes you gotta risk it to get the biscuit. This car was listed for $30,000.
I saw it posted on social media and decided to make an offer, but clearly it wasn't in the best shape.
And because of that, I paid nearly half of what this car was listed at. And we'll get to that breakdown in just a minute. But first, I'm not telling you to just go and lowball everybody on the internet. Because if you bought and sold cars before, you've been on both sides of that equation.
Because it's easy to be hypocritical. On one hand, you wanna get as much as you can out of your car if you're selling it. And on the other hand, if you're buying, you wanna get it for the best deal. But in my case, as a buyer, I was under two forms of risk. One, this car was clearly damaged and it was clearly shown in the photos. And two, it was located in Washington State, which is nearly 1,000 miles away from my house here in Utah. So I submitted my offer to the seller, reluctantly waited a few days, and upon acceptance of the offer, me and my homie Gabe flew all the way out to Washington State with a check in hand, ready to buy this car sight unseen. And when I finally got my eyes on this car, I was actually so stoked because I would have been terribly disappointed if I had overpaid for it, but I got it so cheap that I was more than content with the purchase. Then somehow I thought it'd be a great idea to drive the car nearly 1,000 miles back home from cold, wet, and rainy Seattle, Washington. But there was one problem. This car doesn't have any windows. So I went to a body shop around the corner who entertained my insane idea to drive this thing back home, and they helped me wrap the window voids with some plastic wrap as a temporary fix.
You know, all things just kind of work out as they should. We got the plastic windows in here, boys, we're good.
This thing is actually a hunk of junk.
I don't know what possessed me to think that it was a good idea to drive this all the way back to Utah. It's over 13 hours.
Also, this car came with just a single driver's seat because it's a race car. You'd see in some of the footage, there's just a single race tech seat up front. And there were two of us that flew out to get the car. So for the sake of Gabe's health, I had some newer cars shipped out to my homie Jack's house so we get the car back home. The clearance is so tight right here, but it's like literally perfect.
This one's a little tougher than the other one.
Yeah, it is.
It looks good in there.
What?
Just plopped her in. First test seat, and look at the headroom, man.
Dude, it's crazy. Like, especially without the headliner and like with the cage in.
Yeah.
There's like literally about that much. There's like 7 inches. Then began the 13 hour journey back home, which turned into 2 days after battery kill switch issue, an absurd amount of rain, and of course, those plastic windows lasted all of maybe 30 minutes on the freeway. Also, to top it off, this car has no AC and no heat whatsoever, and it was freezing. Get you some friends like Gabe that will make dumb memories with you, just like this one. Because yes, it was freezing. Yes, he spent over $200 on an overpriced mask, jacket, and blanket at a gas station in the middle of nowhere. And yes, that is two grown men sharing said blanket on the road trip back home.
Dude.
You can even see what you look like right now.
Is this it?
I look like I'm like transporting like the elderly.
Like I feel like I need a wheelchair.
This is so stupid.
Eventually we toughed it out and we got out of the rain. We got out of rainy Washington and finally started making some progress back home to get this car checked out. So where are we going with this? What is the plan? You guys might notice that the M3 is basically a dedicated track car, and that's because we are replacing the C6, which if you guys remember, I wrecked on track due to a suspension component failure
We lost control, sent it straight into the wall. The car was absolutely totaled. And if I'm being honest, I miss that car so much. But the M3 is a little bit metaphorical. We're starting with something that was also wrecked because I wanted to rebuild a car to some extent. The M3 has the perfect amount of damage to rebuild, and kind of metaphorically coming full circle, I'm kind of rebuilding myself because we had the back injury. There's also like, obviously there's kind of some mental stuff that goes along with that. When you hit the wall that hard, it's a little traumatizing, and I feel like it has helped to have the simulator in my basement to be able to get like log some hours on that to start to feel more comfortable again. But this series is all about getting the car and getting myself back on track. But I'm scared not to get back on track, but because of the condition that this car is in. I'm afraid I bit off more than I can chew, so let's just get the first look out of the way. First impressions. Overall, I've got some good things and bad things to say. Good thing, underneath, the car looks absolutely mint. It's got a few upgraded bits here in the suspension, kinematics. Oh, there's Andrew in the cup car. He's headed out right now. It has some upgraded cooling mods as well. We've got a CSF radiator, CSF oil cooler. We've got a power steering cooler. A lot of this stuff has been upgraded. You can see there's some aftermarket bushings there. It's got front and rear sway bars, and underneath, overall, I'd give it like an 8.5 out of 10. It is actually super clean. You can also see they added some jack points right here. There's one on this side and one on that side when they did the cage, which is gonna be super convenient. Also, you can see we're on the stock exhaust right here. That's gotta go because it sounds like absolute trash. This carbon door is actually really nice. The paint isn't in the best condition. It could be better. These fenders, gotta go, I think. So if you have an E92 M3 and you want fenders, I will probably be selling those soon. Front bumper is also like completely destroyed. There's obviously some bugs and stuff on here from the road trip, but we've got holes drilled here. We've got all sorts of damage and just stuff like hanging off the bottom that we're gonna have to take off and replace. But the main reason that we're here at Riot today is one, to get a full check over underneath and make sure everything is dialed. And two is so we can weigh it. And that's so we can see how the weight is distributed. We're gonna get a scale under each corner so we know exactly how much weight is on each tire so we can properly spec the coilovers, because Fortune Auto is gonna build a custom set as they do for every single customer. This vehicle is a little bit more of a special case scenario because it is stripped, because it is a race car, and the weight distribution has changed. If you have a closer to stock vehicle, it's not gonna matter as much, but we're gonna go ahead and grab the corner weight so we know what the spring rate is and how we're gonna valve the whole system. Okay, and not bad. A little bit front heavy as we expected because it is stripped and basically there's nothing in the trunk, but of course we have the motor up front, but not bad. A cross weight of 49.52%. We've got about 850 to 880 pounds up front, 750 in the rear, for a grand total of 3,230 pounds. I think we can get it maybe just a touch lighter. We're gonna go lighter on the wheels. We're gonna be cutting a lot of these body panels out as well, and we're gonna be doing a lighter trunk as well, but we're gonna have a wing up there, so we're gonna have to adjust for some of that stuff. Now, I've never done body work in my entire life, and this isn't exactly the easiest thing to start with for your first body panel job. And to give you a little bit of perspective on this, this door doesn't even open. Gabe had to climb in and out of the window with no glass to sit in here. So the current thinking is that we can cut right along this body line here, replace this lower section down here, and I think we're gonna have to end up replacing some of this. But the first order of business, we need to order a new door. We need to figure out a donor car or an OEM factory replacement from BMW to replace this rear quarter section. And realistically, we gotta figure out how to open this door. But bringing this full circle, I found this car listed for $30,000 and it had absolutely close to zero interest because of the damage right here on the passenger side of the car. But again, my thought process was, if I can get this thing cheap enough, then maybe it still makes sense, even with all the damage on the car. So I swallowed my pride, decided to send the seller a message, and this is what we ended up on. I offered him $15,000. But again, the car was listed for $30,000. So we ended up meeting somewhere in the middle. We settled on $17,000. But the biggest question mark here still was how much was this gonna cost to fix? And this, boys and girls, is still the biggest question mark. So what do you think? Did I make out like a bandit? And did I get a screaming deal on this car for the damage that's on it? Or did I completely screw myself? Well, whether we're prepared for it or not, we're gonna find out in the next video as we dig more into this thing, whether or not we got a good deal on it. Next time we're gonna get that door off, we're gonna get a baseline track time for this car around East Track at Utah Motorsports Campus, the exact same place where the C6 was wrecked. But we need that baseline time because we wanna be able to compare it to something when this car is finally completed. Because remember, at this point, this car has a few cooling mods, but besides that, it's stock suspension, it's stock brakes. These tires are absolute trash. We drove on these all the way back from Seattle. But this car is such a good base to start from because it's stock, but the interior work is pretty much all already done. It has the full cage. We already did the Recaro, so we have a lot of the work done on the interior. So this is a great base to start with. But as usual, if you guys made it this far in the video, you're a real one. Thank you so much for coming along. If you're new here, be sure to hit that subscribe button, and I'll see you guys in the next one.